Adma, you're now the host. You may start. Adma?
Yes, David?
Yes, please proceed.
Oh, thank you.
Yes.
Thank you so much for the privilege once again of sharing this information with colleagues local in Zimbabwe and abroad. And I would want to acknowledge once again the Fetal Medicine team, where I've gotten the knowledge which I'll be sharing and the experience. We started from scratch about 2 years ago, and special mention to Dr. Werenga, Claudius, our fetal medicine specialist, who was selfless enough to impart this knowledge and expertise and exposure. And right now we are here, and most of the images, all of them actually, which I'll be sharing, are from the work which we do every day at our fetal medicine units at Harare Hospital, which is now Salim Mugabe Fetal Medicine Unit, as well as at Parirenyatwa Mbuyanihanda Fetal Medicine Unit. So all the images which you are going to see are from the work which we are doing. They are not from YouTube, they are not from Google, they are from the works of our hands. So actually what triggered to continue with this area after our introduction about a month ago, there's been some questions which have been coming to my inbox about some areas which people wanted more clarity on. So I believe after this talk, I will be at a better place, one of interpreting the ultrasound findings, of correctly dating a pregnancy, of knowing the importance of centiles, and also to have an appreciation of referring to the next level should you come across abnormal findings. So it's not really that some of you have not been coming across these things, but you might have been coming across them, but not able to pick them up because you'll be deficient in that area or in those areas. So I believe after today, you'll be in a better place to help in the care plan. We have had quite a number. I remember most of the patients which are seen in the private sector or across the country end up usually at the government hospitals and specifically at our fetal medicine units at the Mbuyanihanda or Salim Mugabe maternity hospitals. And ultimately they will come to the fetal medicine unit for an ultrasound scan. So we have had some unfortunate instances whereby a patient would have been scanned somewhere, and sometimes the Dopplers are done. And because possibly of not knowing the gravity or the findings, a patient may be sent back home, and the next time they come to the fetal medicine unit, we are dealing with an IUFD. We have had quite a number of those instances. So I believe after we go through the paces today, most of us will be in a better place of interpreting the findings and the next step, which is important. So it's not just about performing an ultrasound scan, but it's knowing the next step to take. So my presentation outline will be as follows. I will start to give a brief description of pregnancy dating, which is an important facet when dealing with surveillance, growth monitoring, biometry. So we'll also talk about the growth assessment, what it implies, or the implications from different scenarios. We'll talk about biometry and the Dopplers, and what the centers actually mean, the implications. Then I will round off with a case presentation. It's a very interesting case which we handled at our fetal medicine unit at Parenyatwa about 2 years ago. It's very, it's quite an outstanding case of the importance of surveillance. All right, so you can see here we've got these different renowned unions, and all of them agree that pregnancy dating is very, very important. It cannot be overemphasized. Why? Because a pregnancy, which is an unknown gestational age, is not of much importance. It presents a dilemma to the managing obstetrician or clinician, because they will not know when to do timing of appropriate obstetric care, as well as in interventions. For example, when should they induce a pregnancy? Won't it be too early? Won't it be too late? So pregnancy dating is quite important. It also plays a vital role in scheduling and interpretation of certain antepartum tests, fetal growth assessment, which we'll be talking about in greater detail, is also premised upon an appropriately dated pregnancy. Also preterm and postterm births prevention strategies are also hinged upon a well-dated pregnancy, as well as to obtain best obstetric estimate for research and fetal surveillance. So there are various ways in which pregnancies are dated traditionally. And commonly used is the menstrual history using the LNMP and the Nagel's rule. However, using the LNMP on its own in almost half of the instances, research has shown that using the LNMP on its own can be unreliable in almost half of the patients. Why? Because there are certain assumptions which have to be satisfied for us to use the LNMP, which include regularity of the cycle and the assumption that ovulation would have taken place on the 14th day, that the woman has not been on contraception, oral contraception or hormonal contraceptives for at least 3 months. So all those assumptions come into play when you use LNMP. So in quite a number of pregnant women, you might find that LNMP can be unreliable. Uh, Then we have the ultrasound, the sonographic methods of estimation of gestational age, the most reliable one being the crown rump length, which we appropriately do between 11 to 13 plus 6 days gestational period. Why is this period important? Because we can also do some other profiling on the fetus. For example, you can flag using some soft markers of chromosomal abnormalities. Remember the nuchal translucency, tracker speed regurgitation, nasal bone presence or absence. These ones can be done during this period when the fetus is between 45 and 84 millimeters. But you can still do the CRL before 11 weeks. You can do it, I think, from around 7 weeks. You're able to use the CRL and date a pregnancy, but usually we prefer the 11 to 13 plus 6 day duration, because that's when you can do the other things besides dating of the pregnancy. Then these days, it's now quite, it's gaining popularity or eminence, that is IVF pregnancies. So you find you will come across quite a number of pregnant women who come having conceived through assisted reproductive therapy. So in those women, you don't need to, it's actually the gold standard of pregnancy dating. Why? Because the conception is known. Remember, when we are using the LNMP, it's based on the assumption that ovulation will occur on the 14th day. But for IVF pregnancies, the sperm and the egg are fertilized in under laboratory settings, so it's actually known. So this one is actually the gold. So if a woman comes having conceived via IVF, they'll be having their gestational age. We don't change that. Okay, so we said the gold standard sonographically is the crown rump length measurement, ideally between 11 and 13 plus 6 days period. So what happens when a woman comes in the second trimester after the period where we should be doing the CRL has lapsed? So in that instance, using the fetal medicine foundation guidelines, we use the head circumference to date this pregnancy. Some of you might start asking why head circumference, why not BPD, why not femur length, why not abdominal circumference? You know, in Africa, we've got a very high burden of preeclampsia or gestational hypertensive disorders of pregnancy. So usually the head is paired. So it's highly unlikely to be affected. Why? Because there's the brain sparing effect, which causes the head to, in most instances, to maintain its upper growth and development. So on the head, why the head's circumference? Why? Because BPD can be affected by some normal variants. We know of dolichocephaly and brachycephalic heads, which can overestimate or underestimate. So the head circumference then comes head and shoulders above the BPD as a way of estimation just of gestational age from the second trimester, that is from 14 weeks onwards. Then some of you might ask, why not the average of the four measurements or three measurements? Why not the average which is given by the ultrasound machine? So as we said, the femur and the abdomen can be affected when there is preeclampsia, in the background of preeclampsia or other hypertensive disorders of pregnancy. So if we average them into giving the gestational age, you can actually end up underestimating the correct gestational age and miss growth-restricted fetuses or babies. Okay, so from the second trimester, when you can no longer do the CRL, we use the head circumference. That's the recommendation based on the Fetal Medicine Foundation. Okay, so I had talked about this point that we do not use the summary, which comes from the machine. And the other important thing which has to take note, which you need to take note of, is that once a pregnancy has been correctly dated or has been assigned a gestational age, it is imperative that we do not continue redating that pregnancy. What do I mean? A woman comes for an ultrasound scan, let's assume in the first trimester, and you perform a CRL and it gives you an EDD of 8 August 2021. Then they come again, possibly after 2 months or after a month, you do the measurements. Then you use the average of the four biometric measurements. Then the EDD now becomes 17 August. Then you write on the report that the EDD is now 17 August. Possibly they come again after 3 months. Then now it's 18 August, so you don't kill, you end up confusing. It will appear as if the baby will be born several times. So once we correctly assign a gestational age to a fetus, we do not change. We stick to that EDD. What all the other subsequent scans will do is now to assess the growth of that fetus. I think that's very important. I think most of us are guilty of assigning different EDDs during one pregnancy. So it's quite important to take note that once a pregnancy has been correctly dated, whether using head circumference or using CRL, or if the LNMP is correct, once that pregnancy has been dated, there is no need to continue changing the EDD. What all the other scans should be doing is surveillance to see how the baby, whether they are growing well or not. Okay. Then there's this interesting aspect of pregnancy redating. So pregnancy redating occurs when there is a certain discrepancy which we think is more than the threshold. So if the LNMP gestational age and the ultrasound assigned gestational age, which we said we are using the head circumference. If the pregnancy is between 14 and 16 weeks, and there is a discrepancy of more than 7 days, either less or more, we redate that pregnancy using the ultrasound measurement, and we discard the LNMP gestational age. So what do I mean here? Let's say a woman comes and she says, I'm sure, that's what all of them always say, I'm sure of my dates, and the dates are corresponding to, let's say 14 weeks. Then we do the ultrasound, we measure the head circumference, and the head circumference, let's say, gives us 16 weeks. Once we have that scenario, we will discard the LNMP and assign the 16 weeks which we got from the head circumference. That becomes the gestational age of that pregnancy. So how are we going to assess or evaluate the 16 weeks which we have given to that pregnancy? What we're going to do is we're going to rescan them after at least 2 weeks to now assess the fetal growth. So if we have said today it's 16 weeks, then we rescan them after 2 weeks. We expect that the pregnancy would have progressed by the 2 weeks. So the next time we scan them after 2 weeks, we see that it's now at 18 weeks. Then we know that the baby is growing well. And actually we'll get the centiles. I think I'll be talking about the centiles in a short while. So in that instance, if the pregnancy is between 16 and 22 weeks, and we find a discrepancy of more than 10 days, between the head circumference gestational age and the LNMP, then we will discard the LNMP gestational age. If it's between 22 and 28 weeks and the discrepancy is more than 14 days, then we'll also discard the LNMP and redate that pregnancy using that day we would have scanned the fetus, the gestational age you'll get from the head circumference. Then, as I said, then you will order a rescan after at least 2 weeks to assess fetal growth. More than 28 weeks, we in the third trimester, we don't usually recommend redating a third trimester pregnancy. Why? There are high chances that you can redate a growth restricted pregnancy. Remember, in the third trimester, there are growth spurts and we'll be nearing the decision to deliver. So what's important then, what you can do is you can assign the, you know, we have several of these cases whereby the woman shows up in the third trimester, they are not sure of their dates, or possibly they are just guessing their dates. Then in that instance, or in that scenario, what is imperative is we measure the head circumference and all the other parameters, but we use the head circumference to assign a gestational age to say, let's say 30 weeks, according to the head circumference. Then we'll recommend a rescan after at least 2 weeks. Then we can compare whether there is consistency. If there is consistency, then we can be sure that the reassigned date is on the accurate side. So what are the surveillance tools which we use for growth monitoring? We use the biometry These are some of the graphs. I think we'll be talking about them. We used the Dopplers. I think we touched on this when I introduced the topic during my first presentation the other day. So we used the umbilical, the midocerebral artery. We also used the ductus venosus, and we also measure amniotic fluid. All right. So I'm usually the fetal parts, which we measure routinely for biometry. We measure the head and the Fetal Medicine Foundation. Standard, we use the transventricular plane. Other institutions use the transthalamic, but we use the transventricular. Why the transventricular plane? Because it gives us the added advantage of measuring both BPD and head circumference at the same plane. And these are the structures which we need. So remember, for you to do growth surveillance and for you to be able to pick fetal growth restriction, you must be able to be doing your biometry consistently. So you should always ensure that when you're doing not everything round is a head circumference, but there should be some structures which should be present for you to say I've appropriately performed a head circumference. So these include the cavum, septum, pellucidum, this box-like structure anteriorly. Then we've got the third ventricle here. Then we've got these heart-like or bean-like structures, the thalami. Then we've got the posterior horn of the lateral ventricle and the choroid plexus in there, and the midline or the fulx. Okay, so, and the rugby ball. It mustn't be a football, it must be a rugby ball. So this is the appropriate plane for measuring your head circumference. So why is this important? So that when they come back again after 2 weeks or after 3 weeks or after 4 weeks, you're comparing like to like. You don't want to compare different portions. You will get inaccurate results. Okay, so the same applies for the abdomen. So for the abdomen, this is the correct plan, whereby you have got the umbilical vein turning into the portal sinus, you've got the stomach, then you've got an adrenal gland, and you've got your vertebral body. We prefer it at the 3 o'clock or at the 9 o'clock position because of the shadow. If it's at 12 o'clock, the shadow will obscure everything. So we prefer it at the 3 o'clock portion. And there should be at least one rib. You shouldn't find broken ribs. Once you see broken ribs, it implies you're in an oblique plane. Then you've got your femur and we measure it from, we shouldn't include the metaphyseal plate. We should measure the diaphysis of the femur. Okay. And it should be horizontal. And another thing, which I think you may have noticed, we zoom our images. They should occupy at least 2/3 of the screen. Shouldn't have a small head which you are closing one eye for you to measure at the corner. You should zoom it and you can see the clarity improves. All right. So I now want to talk to introduce the issue about centiles. So in terms of charts or nomograms, we've got different types, which include customized, population-based, and some general nomograms. So currently, I think we are currently using the hard block formulas. I think as we continue collecting more data of our pregnant women, we ultimately will need to have our customized population-based charts for our population. So, but in the meantime, I think we can work with the hardlock that's been proven to be good. Right. So these nomograms so when you talk about centiles, we're talking about they are based on a large cohort of patients. In this instance, pregnant women who have been sampled, and they establish those who will be being appropriately.
So, what impact will this reported growth have? I'm joined now by.
Let me try to mute. There's someone who is giving us some bit of feedback. All right. So sorry for that. So I'll continue. I was talking about these centiles. So they're mainly divided into three main categories. The first category has to do. We'll talk about the normal. So the normal, anything which is between the 10th and the 90th centile, we refer that as appropriate for gestational age. Anything, so when you've dated a pregnancy, then you do a subsequent ultrasound scan examination of that patient. We said after at least 2 weeks, the machine will then use the gestational age you would have assigned to give you what I referred to as centiles. So the centiles will determine if the baby is growing appropriately or if they are not growing well, or if they are growing at an accelerated pace. So if they are growing well, their centile will be between 10 and 90. So from the 10th to the 90th centile, we say that's appropriate for gestational age. Then from above 90th centile, we say the baby is large for gestational age. And anything below the 10th centile becomes, we term that small for gestational age. So this is where our growth disorders comes in. Remember, we want interpretation of fetal growth restriction. So in terms of this portion of the graph, this morpho gestational age, there are three broad categories which causes fetuses to be small. So we've got 20% being constitutionally small fetuses, whereby the smallness of the baby is as a result of genetics. So possibly the husband and the mother carrying the baby, they are not vertically gifted. So in that instance, you will find that the fetus will also be small, but they are not small because they are not well. They are small because that's their genetic disposition. So that's usually about 20% of small babies. Then we've got what are referred to as abnormal small babies. That's this 15%. Usually they're as a result of infections, the torches infection, toxocytomegalovirus, as well as chromosomal abnormalities. So these ones constitute about 15%. So these are, they are no longer just small, but they are small because they are underlying causes. And these ones we really have to dig deeper because some of the conditions are lethal and we have to pick them up and appropriately manage such pregnancies. Then the majority, I talked about the high burden of preeclampsia in sub-Saharan Africa. The majority which you come across are the ones which we refer to as starving small. And the starving small babies constitute almost 2/3 of all small babies. And these ones are mainly due to placental insufficiency. And if you still remember from the last presentation, there are some sonographic features of infections, which I mentioned. Like for infections, we mentioned about calcifications in the liver or periventricular calcifications. Then we talked about trisomy. We talked about an abnormally large placenta with abnormal texture. Placental insufficiency, you talked about a grade 3 placenta with calcifications. All right. So I'll move on to, I think I've already talked about this. So I mentioned all this. So another important factor has to do with the estimated fetal weight. So I said centiles apply for each and every parameter of a dated pregnancy. So if a pregnancy has been dated, whether by CRL or whether the LNMP is correct, or it has been dated by head circumference and we do subsequent scans, each parameter which you measure, you will get a percentage on the machine if the machine has been correctly calibrated or the settings have been set correctly. So if you measure the head circumference itself, it will give you a centile. If you measure the BPD, it will give you a centile. If you measure the abdominal circumference, it will give you a centile. If you measure the femur length, it will give you a centile. And you see whether the centile is falling within the appropriate for gestational age range, or the large for gestational age, or the small for gestational age. That's for each and every parameter. However, we record that, but what we ultimately look at is the weight. So, you know, the weight is an aggregation into a formula of all those parameters with different weight weightings. The abdomen usually has a lion's share in as far as estimated fetal weight is concerned. So all of them are included and they give us an estimated fetal weight. Then we then determine if that weight is appropriate for gestational age. Is the weight small for gestational age, or is it large for gestational age? All right. So here, there's a new aspect which is coming in. I think we introduced it last week about fetal growth restriction. We said we've got early onset and we've got late onset fetal growth restriction, and the cutoff being 32 weeks. So if the pregnancy is below 32 weeks and we flag that the estimated fetal weight, so by our standard at the fetal medicine units in Zimbabwe, which I also, for standardization purpose, you can also implement them at your departments. We use the a weight cutoff of 10th centile. So if the weight is below 10th centile, that's more for gestational age. Just for caution sake, we said in the presence of the preeclamptic burden which we have, it's better to be cautious than to be, you know, to be carefree. So it's better to be cautious and treat it as an FGR. There's no harm in surveillance, but there is harm in non-surveillance because it can have some catastrophic outcomes. So if the estimated fetal weight is below the 10th centile, we flag that pregnancy as fetal growth restriction. Then we'll move on to the Dopplers to interrogate the Dopplers, which I'll be touching in a few minutes to come. All right, so these are the centiles I was talking about. A pregnancy or an ultrasound scan report, which does not have centiles, is not so helpful. Just to be polite, is a not so helpful scan to the obstetrician. So a scan which just measures BPD, head circumference, abdominal circumference, femur length, then you tell us it's 23 weeks, 4 days. It doesn't help because we don't know whether the baby is growing well or not. So it's very, very important. If you have not been doing it, I think from tomorrow, start ensuring that all the pregnancies which should be having centiles or all the ultrasound scan examinations which should be having centiles, you send the report with the centiles because it will inform the obstetrician or the one caring for that pregnancy, whether the baby is growing well, whether is there any need of any intervention, is there any need of modification of the care plan. So when a pregnancy has been dated, as I said, whether by LNMP, whether it was previously dated using CRL, or it was dated previously using head circumference, and they come for subsequent scans, you will get this percentage. If your machine doesn't, make sure you get the necessary help so that it gives you this percentage and it will help you to start producing ultrasound reports which are meaningful to the obstetricians. Because now what's happening, previously you could get away with it because some of the obstetricians were not knowledgeable about this, but now the majority of them now know about this because we've been carrying out some trainings and some awareness about the importance of these things. Remember, ultimately, it goes to us reducing unnecessary deaths. Remember the statistics I quoted the other time about our high, especially in Zimbabwe. I think it might also apply for other African countries. We've got a high perinatal and maternal mortality rates. And some of these things, if we start implementing them, it will help us to flag the necessary pregnancies and they are managed appropriately. So you can see here, we've got some appropriate for gestational age, so you know this one was supposed to be appropriate and appropriate as well. It's not small because 18 is between 10 and 90, 23 is also between 10 and 90. And the weight, you also get a centile. If it's between 10 and 90, the center of the estimated fetal weight, then it will be appropriate. If it's less than, then it's more for gestational age. And if it's more than 90th centile, it becomes large for gestational age. All right, now moving on to the Dopplers. So the biometry don't go alone. They go hand in hand with the Dopplers. So we've got the uterine arteries. I think I mentioned about the technique last week. They cross the iliacs at 90 degrees. And these are the normal wave forms with good end-diastolic flow. All right, so this is a normal wave of the uterine arteries. Okay, these ones now are abnormal uterine arteries. As you can see, we said for us to say that it's normal, there should be a good end-diastolic flow. So you can see here now the diastolic flow has reduced in comparison with the systolic contractions. And you can see also there is this bump, which we term notching. So this one, you can even see from the figure that this is a high PI. This one is measured 1.67. It's quite high. And this one also is on the high side. So this one's become abnormal. So what is their significance? They will inform us that there is some resistance to blood flow to the placenta, which might have implications on the perfusion of the fetus. So they can be an indicator of placental insufficiency if there is this high resistance as evidenced by these graphs. Then for the umbilical, which we talked about, which is also part of the surveillance, the umbilical, it must also have good end diastolic. And this one is now starting to reduce. You can see the end diastolic is reducing. So this one becomes a high PI. So this one is normal. This one is starting to reduce to become a high PI. And as it continues to deteriorate, it will become absent. So during diastole, there won't be any flow. And as it continues to deteriorate, then it will become reversed. So there will now be reversal of flow, which means the babies will be deteriorating further and further. This is another graphical representation of the deterioration through surveillance of the umbilical. You can see here, it's a high PI, but it's continuing to deteriorate as the end diastolic is continued to diminish, absent, and becomes reversed. The MCA, so when in MCA, we said it's a high resistance vessel, so we should be normally having a high PI. So when an MCA is normal, it should have a high PI. When an umbilical is normal, it should be having a lowish PI. So when it is like this, then this is normal. You can see it has got very reduced end diastolic, which is normal for the MCA. Here, it's now starting to vasodilate and having decreased resistance, which we said is a sign of redistribution. And we said redistribution, which can also be referred to as brain sparing, is a consequence of possible fetal hypoxia. So if we have got limited supply of oxygen, we will give preferential supply to the brain. And it's evidenced by the decrease in the pulsatility index or in the resistance to blood flow to the brain. Then of course the ductus venosus. So these ones are normal. Catalyzing effect, ductus venosus, they are normal. And here you can see now that the AUF, you can compare, this one you can see the AUF is high up there near the diastole and even near the systolic peak. Same applies here. But when you look here, this AUF, this depression, the atrial wave contraction, you can see now it's reduced, which means there is now resistance at the level of the heart. Same here, it's now even worsening. It's almost showing some signs of reversal here, which might be pointing towards heart failure. Okay, so this is the ductus venosus deteriorating, starting with a high PI, with a reduced AWF, then a reversal, then you can see it's even deteriorating further there. All right, so this is the summary which I can recommend you to use at your centers, which we use at our fetal medicine units. So we've got the umbilical Doppler, we've got the middle cerebral artery Doppler, we've got the ductus venosus Doppler, then we've got the right uterine artery, this one was supposed to be left, okay, and the left uterine artery. Then we've got the mean uterine artery PI. So when it's normal, we said, so all these are also measured with central, but if you have, if you continue performing them, you end up knowing even before you go to the nomogram, you just know that this one looks, it has a good end diastole, it's normal. This one, it has a very reduced end diastole. This should be a high PI in the umbilical artery. So you end up knowing, but you have the advantage or the luxury of using graphs or centiles. Yeah, so if you measure, but our main emphasis, which we focus on mainly, it's mainly the pulsatility index compared to the resistive index. Though the resistive index also has centiles, but we usually prefer the pulsatility index. Why? Remember, the resistive index, when there is absent end diastolic flow, it always gives you a figure of one. But for the pulsatility index, you always get a figure which you can put in the centiles. So, yeah, so that's for the umbilical. So this one is normal. Then the middle cerebral artery, you can see that this is a high PI from just seeing the figure. So, but this one will need to be correlated with the gestational age. So it will also give you a centile. An important addition to the MCA is the peak systolic velocity. This one only applies for the MCA. It doesn't apply for the other vessels. And this one is a measure of fetal anemia. We'll not talk about that during this talk. Our main focus is mainly the pulsatility indices. So the ductus venosus, this one is a PI of the vein. So if you measure it, then you check if there's a positive AWF, then you can then talk about if the waveform is normal. Then the left and right uterines, you mention if there's any notching or such a thing like that. Then you can see here, we've got our mean uterine PI. Okay, so this one now, I just put some figures so that you can appreciate. You can see that this one is a high PI value. It will be evidenced by the wave. As I said, the waveform, you will see a decreased end diastolic flow. And sometimes it can be decreased end diastolic flow or absent end diastolic flow, even reversed, and it will be evidenced with a high PI. Okay, this one, it was supposed to be, I think, around one. If it's 110 or thereabout, usually that's the one which will be a low PI in the MCA, which is evidenced by increased EDF, which I refer to as redistribution. Then ductus venosus, also all these ones. All these are possible findings depending on the PI which you get here. You shall see on the case which I'll be presenting right away. So we had this 17-year-old premip, which means this was her first pregnancy. Mrs. X, who referred to her as Mrs. X, was referred to the fetal medicine unit for fetal well-being assessment with a diagnosis of malaria, take note of malaria in pregnancy, for about 5 days prior to consult. So her estimated gestational age using the LNMP was 26 weeks Okay, she had conceived naturally. She had booked a pregnancy at 18 weeks, but no scan had been done. There was no other history of chronic illness. Her mother had preeclampsia, and the clinical assessment of the patient was consistent with malaria. So she was diagnosed with malaria and pregnancy. So we performed ultrasound scan examination, obstetric on the patient, and these were the findings, and these were the centiles. So you can see that the centiles, all of them were below the third centile, which is consistent with small for gestational age. And there was no measurable pool of amniotic fluid, and their weight was also 639 grams, which was below the third centile. Then we performed serial scans. You can now see from these graphs. Okay, so you can see, I'm not sure if you can see, but you can see these pluses, which are showing the different scans which we did from the initial scan to the time in which she finally delivered. But here we just wanted to push her to at least 32 weeks. Remember what I said, that as long as the ductus is okay, we will continue surveillance so that the baby gains a bit more weight, and which will boost their chances of survival. So we did, you can see for all the parameters, we've got these serial scans which we performed, and these are the umbilical artery, as well as all the other Dopplers, we performed them consistently. So these were the uterines, they were normal, okay, the right and the left. That's the umbilical. You can see the umbilical, as I described earlier on, you can see that the end diastolic is reduced. So this was a high PI, you can now see from the figure. So before even you see the figure, just based on the waveform, you should be able to pick that this is an abnormal umbilical artery waveform. Okay, you can see that the MCA is the one which looks like the umbilical because it has got a very high end diastolic flow here. So this, it was already redistributing, but the ductus venosus was normal. So as long as the ductus venosus is normal, we can buy some time and keep on performing surveillance. So the ultrasound diagnosis which we made was of early onset fetal growth restriction. Remember, this was before 32 weeks with abnormal Dopplers, likely placental dysfunction secondary to the malaria. Mm-hmm. Okay. So we didn't find any major abnormalities, but the placenta was grade 3. And the Doppler findings were the high PI. I think I showed you the graphs previously. The ductus was normal and the uterine arteries were normal, but these ones were reversal. The umbilical had a high PI and the MCA had a low PI. So since the mother's condition was stable, she was allowed to continue with the pregnancy, and a conservative approach was taken after discussion with the mother. So they were managing the malaria, and we were doing surveillance on the fetus. So we performed fetal Dopplers every 3 days. So every 3 days we're doing fetal Dopplers, and so that we were keeping our eye on the ductus venosus. As long as the ductus venosus was okay, then we knew we could gain some more grams on the fetus. And we're doing growth scans every 2 weeks. So growth scans, you can usually, ideally, you have to do them after at least 2 weeks, not weekly, not after 3 days. But the Dopplers, you can do them more frequently. And our aim was of delivering this fetus at 32 weeks if the ductus venosus had remained normal. All right, so these are the graphs. This one was the weight of the serial scans which we performed. That's the head circumference. This one is the abdominal circumference. That's the umbilical. You can see that it was consistently high. during all the scans which we performed. So this was our miracle baby. That's why we have special interest in this baby, because suddenly things changed. So from the first scan, which had a high PI, it started to improve. The umbilical started to improve. You can see here, there was an increase in the end diastolic flow. And here it was normal. You can see the MCA, it started like this with a low PI, it started to improve. As the malaria was being managed, supposedly the perfusion also started to improve. And look here, it had almost normalized. And the ductus venosus remained consistently normal. So the umbilical artery and the MCA Dopplers normalized. So was the amniotic fluid, which was anhydramnios during the first scan, and it had normalized. And the decision was made to deliver this baby at around 38 and 39. Remember, we're aiming for 32 weeks, but we ended up gating 38 to 39 weeks. A neonatal alert was placed and labor was induced. The baby was delivered. It was alive with a birth weight of 2260 grams, supposed to be grams, 2.260 kgs with an APGAR score of 7 to 9. There was no need to admit her miraculously in the neonatal unit. And they were both discharged by day 2. And they were doing well, both the mother and the baby. So what are lessons from this case and from whatever I've been talking about from the onset of this presentation? Close monitoring of early onset fetal growth restricted babies is possible. So it's not fiction. We're not talking about Pluto or Mars, we're talking about something which can be implemented, which you can play a part using ultrasound and using the knowledge about how to proceed. We also learned that placenta dysfunction associated with malaria may self-resolve with treatment and allow the pregnancy to continue. We also learned that ductus venosus Doppler is an important component in monitoring early onset fetal growth restricted babies. And what we should all strive to, as I said earlier on when I introduced the topic, that we have had some unfortunate instances where we lost some fetuses because the sonographer or the radiographer wasn't really knowing the implications of the scan which they did, and they sent the mother home only to come back with a demised fetus. We want to avoid that. So if we are not sure, let's refer. If you are locally in Harare or anywhere, you can refer to our fetal medicine units. Also, our phone call, our phones are available for you to call if you have any challenges, to ask for an opinion about possibly the findings which you would have come across when you are scanning. So this will actually minimize unnecessary demise of these fetuses. So whenever we come across abnormal centers or Dopplers and you are not sure, be ready to ask for further opinion. Okay, so surveillance is quite important. So small for gestational age infants recognized before birth who undergo surveillance and timely delivery have a 4 to 5-fold reduction in mortality and or severe morbidity, as was with our case, which I presented. So this brings to an end my presentation. So I would like to acknowledge the phytomedicine teams at Mbuyane Handa and at Salim Mugabe. Thank you.
Thank you so much, Sadman, for that presentation. I think that was quite elaborate. At this juncture, I'm going to ask the participants to unmute the microphones so that you may make a contribution, ask questions or any observations where you might need further clarity.